Grace and peace to you all from our Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning. And welcome to First Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are here with us at God's Open House. If you are visiting with us, I want to offer you guys a special welcome and let you know we have friendship hats on the island. We'd love it if you would write down your name and information so that we can reach out to you so we can know that you've been here. And we invite you downstairs after worship for our coffee hour for some time of food and fellowship and enjoyable company. We have a lot coming up in the next couple weeks, so I have a lot of announcements, but I have one in particular that is special to me. I am a new baby. Kate is 3 days old. And we got home from the hospital yesterday, and everybody's doing great. And we just absolutely adore her. We are so excited. It is still cold and flu season, and a bad cold and flu season, so you probably won't see her for a very long time. except in pictures. But I cannot wait to share her with you, and for her to grow and learn and develop in this because of that, I'm going to be out for a couple of weeks, taking care of her, taking care of mom, and taking some time to bond with my new daughter. And so I will be out for the next couple of weeks. I'll be here if there are emergencies. Do call me. But for the most part, I'm not going to be showing up to a lot. And when I do, I will probably be sleep deprived or follow everything for the most. So if you would offer me a little bit of grace and care in the coming weeks, I would deeply appreciate it. Because of that, we're kind of having to do a month of announcements all at once, so get ready. Virtual Easter flowers are due by March 25th. So if you want, we have an order form for flowers. And what happens with our virtual flower program, rather than having a whole ton of flowers that we put up on the sanctuary and we have them for a week and then they're gone, we encourage people to donate virtual flowers. And our worship committee arranges for us to have some flowers up, but the donations go to the Pittman Food Pantry. So all of our memorials, all of our celebrations are turned into good mission work in our community. And I encourage you to support that and to do that. Also coming up, we're putting together our directory for the year, and there's a sample of that directory on the table under the calendar. If you would just check and make sure your name and phone number and information is correct, and if there's any more information, like if you've got a cell phone or something like that, to put that in so that we can make sure it is all correct. If you just check your information. Coming up, I want to run through two more things. We are in the process of scheduling all of our coffee hours for the year. If in the last couple weeks you got a clothespin with a date and you've not written your name in the appropriate slot, please do that. Or send an email to the office with the date that you will be doing it. Just take a look at that calendar and we can start filling in any empty dates that there are. Also, I have... I think a lot of people know this, but George Gruber, who's a longtime member of our congregation, has moved to hospice in the past couple weeks. He is still doing fairly well. He's alert, he's happy, and he loves visitors. And the best time to go and see him is between 10 and 1. And Annie is there to help you with anything that you need. But it's a great chance to go and visit with him. In the next coming few weeks and months, I encourage you to do that because he'd really appreciate it. And now I want to go through our Holy Week. Holy Week is the last week of March. We'll have our Palm Sunday services. And then on... My battery went out. I'm going to be loud for a minute. I'm going to put my battery in. On Thursday, March 29th, we're going to have our Monday Thursday service. That'll be at 7 o'clock p.m. We'll be doing foot washing. It'll be peaceful. It'll be quiet. It'll be a wonderful chance to connect with God and to have some time of prayer and some time of service
to each other and in our community. So I encourage you to join us for that. The next thing that we're going to do is something that I'm kind of excited about. We are going to be doing a virtual vigil over Good Friday through Holy Saturday and into Easter. So rather than inviting people to come into our worship and have prayer and a vigil in the sanctuary, we're going to invite people to sign up for an hour of prayer sometime over the weekend. Any hour that you want, we'll have people pray constantly through the weekend. And then when it's your time to pray, you find your spot, wherever it is. It might be in your backyard, it might be in a park, it might be in your study, and maybe you light a candle or you make some tea or something like that. And then post a picture on Facebook of your spot, or share what you're praying for, or invite others to join you in prayer during that time. And throughout the period from Good Friday at 3 o'clock, which is traditionally in the Gospel of Mark, the moment that Jesus died, all the way up to Holy Saturday at 6 a.m. when the sun comes up, we will be in prayer together as a community. So I encourage you to, once we get that sign-up set up, to sign up for an hour and to find simply a space to pray for an hour. If you've never tried to pray for an hour, it is surprisingly easy. I didn't grow up praying for an hour in my life. I promised somebody I would do it. And just start listing the things that you want to pray for, and the list gets longer and longer and longer, and all of a sudden you looked up, and you've been talking to God for an hour. And it is beautiful, and it's amazing. So I really encourage you to sign up for that and to join us for that. And then we will have a service, a sunrise service, at Alcyon Park at the Pavilion at 6:30 a.m. So feel free to join us for that and ring in the moment that Christ rose with us in that service. It will be a simple service with some music and a few readings, and a great chance to greet the day and to practice our resurrection together. And then we'll have our traditional service at 10 a.m. I look forward to being with you guys for that. Are there any other announcements that we have this week? All right, then let's prepare our hearts for worship by listening to prayer.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters and friends, as far as the east is from the west, so far have your guilt and shame been removed from you. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thank you.
kids to come forward for a moment with the children. We're going to do something a little bit different. I'm going to be inviting parents to come forward for a moment with parents. Kids, please come too. And thank you so much for that beautiful song that you have in my head all the time. Alright, there's going to be a lot of us, so we're going to make some room. Whoever has the creakiest knees can have a chair. And Diana says, could be a parent. You never know. Everybody has knees. In prayer, yes, yes, very good, right? We pray together and we all speak out loud together, and that's another time that it's okay to talk in church. When else is it okay to talk in church? During Sunday school, yeah, we talk during Sunday school, that's true, that's great. Yes? At home. Yes! 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 So when is it okay to talk during the worship service? Passing in a piece. So we have some times during the worship service when we're talking. What about Matthew spoke earlier? He was leading the worship service, so he was talking. Are there other situations in which it's okay to talk at church? What about an emergency? Yes, yes. We always want to make sure that if we're having an emergency, we feel comfortable talking in church. I want to talk about another way that it's appropriate to talk in church, and that is whispering. And it's particularly special for parents, because parents are going to be the ones who need to whisper a lot. A big part of what we do when we bring our family to church is we're teaching our kids to how to worship, how to love, and how to praise God. And if we want to teach them well, we have to explain what's going on. And so one of the things that we need to learn is how to whisper well. When we have little children, it's good to whisper to them so that they know what we're doing and why we're doing it. So, for example, if we are starting our prayer for confession, it's time for us to pray. We're saying we're sorry to God for all of the things that we did that we should not have done. And it's good to whisper to explain things. For our older kids, sometimes it's good to give them a question or something to think about, something to ponder over, something that helps them connect their experience to what they're doing in church. And another great way to talk in church is to whisper to your kid about something that you might love or something that might be meaningful to you, to share what is important to you about worshiping God, about praising God, about coming together to church. And then finally, when we're young, sometimes we have questions. And it is important to ask questions, and it is great to answer questions. And so when you want to know something, you can whisper to your parents and ask a question about what's going on, and your parents can whisper back and help you understand it. So those are all really good times for us to be talking in church, even if nobody else is talking and we're not reading anything. It is when we are doing it so that we can learn more and understand better how to do this big thing that we all come together. to praise and worship God and to get a little bit of nourishment and growth and learning from the Word. Thank you guys so much for coming up. Will you pray with me?
Dear God,
thank you
for gathering us
so that we can care for each other,
learn about you,
and thank you for your blessings.
Help us
to grow together
and to whisper well.
Amen. It is time for some of you to depart.
Our second reading for today comes from the book of Corinthians, and I love the Corinthians and the Corinthian church, because there's not a problem that has happened in the church that the Corinthians did not do first. And so they are a beautiful example for us of what not to do in many cases, and also they inspired this letter in which Paul is sharing with them what matters and what does not matter, and how we should shape and orient our lives. And so in Corinthians, as opposed to Romans, it's a much more sort of theoretical. Paul didn't know the Romans, and so he gave them sort of a theological treatise. But the Corinthians is full, the letters to the Corinthians are full of practical knowledge, of real conflict, of deep challenges, and we can see how Paul is working out with this community in fear and trembling their salvation together. Now, this particular passage is very early in Corinthians, and Paul has finally, in the previous passage, sort of gotten to the point and said, I'm writing because there are problems. And now he is establishing this big baseline. He's saying, remember who you are and who Christ is. So I invite you to listen now to the first letter to the Corinthians,
chapter 1, verses 18 through 31. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater, the sage? Has God not made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Hannah and I went on our honeymoon. We went to Rome, and you know, when you go to Rome, you look at art, which is not something that I know a lot about, but it's kind of what you do. There's a ton of art there, and you go. And if you're in Rome looking at Roman art, you're going to end up with art from the Roman Empire. And art from the Roman Empire has some consistent themes. There are things you'll see. You know, if you look at, it's not in every particular thing, but if you look at sort of big pictures of emperors or sculptures of emperors, there's a famous breastplate of one of the Augustuses that has sort of an image of Caesar right there. You see Caesar, he's reaching up to touch the gods. And if you look below him, in a lot of these pictures, below the emperor in a lot of these pictures, you'll see that he's standing on somebody. There are actually people down there that he's standing on people, and they're broken, and they're bent over. A lot of times they're women, a lot of times they have beards, which for the Romans was like super barbarian. And he's standing on these sort of bearded, effeminate, bent over, hunched over, weak people. These, of course, are the people that Rome conquered. These are all of the different nations that had been forced to submit to Rome, the Phrygians and the Scythians and the Greeks and the Carpathians and, the Corinthians and the Palestinians and the Israelites, and all of the nations that were under Roman rule. And you see this sort of consistently. They always portray people who are under Roman rule in this sort of very negative, very submissive posture. There's a famous coin, a coin called the Judea Capta coin. And when it was printed when Jerusalem was conquered in 70 AD, and it has an image on it, which is, you know, for a coin in Judea, that was already sacrilegious. The image is of a palm tree, and then right next to the palm tree, there's a woman, and she's bent over, and she's crying. And that is a sort of celebration of this victory. And in that art, when you look at that, you have sort of the people down on the bottom, and you have the emperor, and he's reaching up, and he's touching the gods. And it was understood that when the emperor died, he would become a god. And that almost encapsulates Roman theology in a nutshell. Because for Rome, strength was the thing that mattered. Power was the thing that mattered. If you were blessed by the gods, it meant you were powerful. If you were powerful, it meant that you were blessed by the gods. Rome ruled because
the gods loved them because they were powerful. And power is sort of the center of their orientation. The emperor becomes a god because the emperor is the most powerful person. And that's the way the world worked. There are the powerful, and they trample the weak, and that's how it's supposed to be. If it wasn't how it's supposed to be, then the weak would become powerful. And so, when you see this art, you see the sort of image. Roman rule is divinely ordained, for the gods favor the strong, and the weak are punished for their weakness. They're delivered over to the strong. So, when Paul proclaims Christ crucified, when he says, we proclaim Christ crucified, he proclaims a wisdom that would seem absolutely foolish to anyone who is living in the Roman world. Christ was not a conquering emperor. He didn't trample upon the nations. He ministered to the trampled. If the imagery of Rome was all about power and beauty, the imagery of Christianity was exactly the opposite. The primary image of Christianity is the cross. The cross in the ancient world wasn't an image of power as it became in the Middle Ages. It wasn't sort of an image of victory or military dominance or anything like that. It was a form of execution. It was humiliation. It was embarrassing, or it should have been. That's what everybody thought about the Christians was, what are they doing? There's this famous pagan who wrote a polemic against Christianity. He says, look, we know demons rule the world, and those powerful demons are the strongest, and so we worship the strong. But what are these Christians doing worshiping a god who can't even give them a place to lay their heads? Worshiping a dead god. It doesn't make any sense. It is a subversion of the natural order to worship someone like that. That's how it was considered offensive. When Rome burned, the saying Nero fiddled while Rome burned, Rome blamed Christians for it. Not because they were doing anything crazy or weird, but because they worshipped a weak god, it subverted the natural order, and it was causing natural disasters. That's how foolish this particular wisdom seemed to be. And so we can imagine how foolish the Corinthians would have felt for proclaiming this message, Christ crucified. Their friends would ridicule them, their co-workers would mock them, their neighbors would spread nasty rumors without them being cannibals, because they really didn't understand the eating the body of Christ thing. And depending on who the, no joke, it was a real thing. There were rumors that Christians were cannibals because they heard that they ate their Lord every week. And a lot of the early Christian apologias, the early Christian defenses, are in response to this accusation of cannibalism. And depending on who the Roman governor was, who was there at that time, partaking in that kind of foolishness could even be dangerous. And nowadays, it's not particularly dangerous to be Christian, at least in the United States. It's no longer strange or unusual. If you admit in front of your coworkers that you're a Christian, chances are you're not going to be punished. Nobody accuses you of being a cannibal. But there is still a fundamental foolishness to this gospel. William Willimon, who's a famous preacher and formerly the dean of the chapel at Duke, he puts it this way. He said, be honest, man. Blessed are the meek. Try being meek tomorrow at work and see how far you get. Meekness is fine for church, but in the real world, the meek get to go home early with a pink slip and a pat on the back. Blessed are those who are peacemakers. They shall get done to them what they are loath to do to others. Blessed are the merciful. They shall get it done a second time. Anybody who lives in the real world knows that the message of the cross is foolishness. In the real world, people take advantage of you. You can't count on the world to treat you fairly. You can't trust other people to have everybody's interest at heart. And so, as citizens of the world, we put our trust in things that seem reliable. We put our trust in financial security, thinking that if we could just have a little bit more, then we'd be okay. We could be sure of our future? Can we put our faith in power? We fight for positions of prestige in the world, and sometimes even in the church, believing that if we could just have a little bit more control over our world, we wouldn't have to worry so much. When we demand respect from others based on status, our past success, our achievements, and we judge other people by what they've accomplished. And when we do these things, they feel like the smart thing to do. Because in the real world, as often as not, everybody else is doing the same thing. Looking for security, trying to control the world that we live in, judging each other on the basis of our strength and our accomplishments. But Paul tells us that that wisdom is only for those who are perishing. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Because no matter how hard we try to control our fate, no matter how hard we try to determine how things are going to go for us, how much energy and effort we put into our own security, into our own control, into our own understanding, the truth is that these things aren't things that we can create for ourselves. We can't give ourselves security. We can't give ourselves control. We can't give ourselves strength. When I was a kid, I used to go to the arcade at the mall. And being a kid, my mom would give my brother my quarters, and I would blow them all in like 20 minutes. And you know, now you're stuck with the arcade, and you're trying to figure out what you're going to do. And I always wander over to the driving simulators. You know, where you get in there, and there's a steering wheel there, and they're always playing a video on those simulators. They're sort of giving you a demonstration that says, you know, press the start or put your quarter in the start, and the video is intentionally bad. I don't know if you notice this, but it always crashes in the first lap. And I think the point is to try to get you to be like, hey, I can be better than that, and put your quarters in. But, of course, I never had any quarters, so I would always get up in there and climb in, and on that first turn, it's turning right, I turn to the right. And on that second turn, it's turning to the left, I turn to the left, and when we got to a straightaway, I just mashed that pedal, and it really felt like I was driving that car. It really felt like it was going. Until two turns later, all of a sudden, wham, I'm turning the wheel, but it's going straight into the wall. And in a way, that's a little bit the way life is. We can feel like we're in control. We can sit in the driver's seat, and we can turn that wheel, and we can feel like we are directing the car. But at some point, something happens, and we realize that we were not doing anything. That it was out of our control. That all of this was sense of control was just an illusion. That's what it is to put our faith in human wisdom. And it gives us comfort. It makes us feel like we're in control when we're not. We can act like we have some sort of control over the world, like we're driving the car, but we're not. Those who are perishing, they can't see beyond the end of the simulation. They can't see beyond this world. So they can turn the wheel, thinking that somehow if they turn it hard enough or fast enough or carefully enough, they'll be able to manage it somehow. But the truth is that no amount of money, no amount of success, no amount of power, no amount of control will give us that sense of security, that sense of safety, that sense of control over our world. Because only God has control of the world. We can't save ourselves by striving. Only God can save us. But the beauty of this reality is that we're not saved by money, by intelligence, by status, even by our actions. We are saved by the free grace of God. We're saved by a God who came to us not as a ruler or a king, but as a servant who died on a cross. So that no one would be able to boast in their own accomplishments or hold themselves higher than other people on account of who they were or what they had, Christ crucified proclaims that there's something more to the world than human wisdom that puts its trust in fame and fortune. The wisdom of the cross seems like foolishness to some, but to those who are clinging to some semblance in a world that is completely unpredictable. But while it seems like foolishness to those who are perishing, it is wisdom for those who are saved. See, This is God's way of telling us what God's rule is like. It's not about driving the bus. It's about going out into the world to serve, to love, and to bless someone else. God's reign, God's rule, the way the world is oriented, when it's oriented around the cross, it doesn't look like, I gotta get mine. It looks like, how can I serve you? It looks like, how can I bless somebody else? Because that is where God's wisdom really is. That, in the end, is what rules the world. So the question that we have to ask ourselves today and every day is, are we going to be people of the world? Are we going to be people of this world? Or are we going to be people of God's kingdom? Are we going to be people of the next world? Are we putting our trust in human things? Or are we storing up our treasures in heaven, far more permanent than here? Are we seeking our own wisdom? Or have we come to realize that the greatest wisdom is not that which we find through our own striving, but wisdom that we perceive through God's revelation to us? Hannah's favorite author is this guy named Haruki Murakami. He's a Japanese author. I like him a lot, too. He writes this sort of gloriously weird books. But he has a way of thinking and a way of writing that I don't know, find something beautifully real and often spiritual in his novels. And at one point, in his life, he made a controversial choice. And he got a lot of criticism for that particular choice. And so he wrote an open letter about who he is and what he believed. And in that letter, he gave me this metaphor that I think speaks in a lot of ways to what Jesus means in the world. Murakami said, between a high, solid wall and an egg that breaks against it, I will always be on the side of the egg. Now, this world, that is foolishness. The egg is never going to win. I mean, eggs are fragile. They break easily. Walls are built to be strong. They don't. I would challenge you to try this out in your own home if you'd like. It's foolish, right? Walls break eggs. It makes no sense if you're picking teams to pick an egg's team. You know? It's like asking Humpty Dumpty to be your security guard. It doesn't get you anywhere. In the same way that it makes no sense to align yourself with Christ crucified. In the Roman world, it makes sense to align yourself with the emperor, to the powerful one, and worship him, and hope that some of that blessing falls down on you. It doesn't make any sense to align yourself with Christ crucified. It's foolish to believe that weakness can overcome strength is foolishness. But the true foolishness is that when Jesus confronted Rome, when this fragile, weak head ran up against that high, solid wall, it wasn't the egg that broke. It was the wall. And by the power of God who saved Jesus from death, we too are saved not by our own power, but Christ's. In dying, he gave us life. Being a Christian isn't so much believing in miracles, believing in any miracle or all miracles. It is believing in this particular miracle and orienting and shaping our life around it. That our powerless Jesus on the cross, that Christ crucified, is victorious. He defeated the cross. He defeated Rome. He defeated death itself. And if we follow him, we will find that victory. We will find eternal life. So my message to you today is this. Be foolish. Love more than is reasonable. Share more than is sensible. Forgive more than is plausible. Stand up for the weak when you cannot possibly win. align yourself with Christ crucified, knowing that the impossible has been made possible, that death itself no longer limits us, for in Christ we are participants in a new kingdom, where the wisdom of the real world is foolishness, and each of us, regardless of our own achievements, of our own power, of our own resources, has been saved by the power of God and born into new life, free from the powers of sin and death. Be foolish. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now we have a brief moment for mission. John Ridge is going to come and tell us a little bit about our Stephen ministry, one of the wonderful ways that we in this church take care of each other and care for our community.
Questions like, are we all named Stephen or Stephanie? No. Are we the ones with the uniforms and the kettles at Christmas? Are we the monks who make brandy? For the past 6 years, Stephen Ministry has provided our congregation with one-to-one long-term Christian care for people hurting from loss of health, a job, a loved one, or some other life crisis. A Stephen minister is a member of our congregation who provides care for one person, usually meeting for an hour each week, to listen, care, and pray, as well as offer emotional and spiritual support for his or her caregiver. If that sounds something like a good friend would do, that's because a Stephen minister is a caring friend for someone in need. Our Stephen ministry needs a few more good men and women to be caring friends for people in our congregation who need another friend. Stephen ministry volunteers receive training, guidance, and regular support meetings to help them in their mission. To find out more about Stephen ministry, you're welcome to contact me, Margaret Ginter, Ron Griffith, Bev Currier, or Pastor Drew for more information. If you can be a good friend, you can be a great Stephen minister. Give us a call.
Remembering the gift of God's love, let us offer our gifts to the Lord.
Thank you.
Remembering all your acts of mercy and light. We take this bread and this wine from the gifts that you have given us, and we celebrate with joy the redemption won for us in Jesus Christ. Accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, as a living and holy offering of ourselves, that our lives may proclaim the one crucified and risen. For great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread that we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ and with all who are baptized in his name, that we may be one in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Let your Spirit empower the life we share and enliven our witness in the world. With all the saints who have gone before us, keep us faithful to the gospel. Give us strength to serve you until the promised day of resurrection, when with the saints of all the ages we will feast with you in glory. O Lord, as we prepare to celebrate this sacrament, we offer up these prayers for our world, for our neighbors, and for ourselves. O Lord, we lift up to you all of creation, its glorious bounty, its beauty, its majesty. And we ask that you help us to protect it, help us to share it, help us to steward it for your will and for your kingdom. O Lord, we lift up our leaders, the leaders of our church, our session, our trustees, and our deacons, the leaders of our community, our mayor, our council, our state legislature and governor, the leaders of our nation, our Congress and our president. And we ask, Lord, that you be their guide, that you help so that their lives might reveal Christ crucified, right? Might reveal this foolish proclamation of your love for all. Lord, we lift up to you all those who suffer throughout the world, those who are sick, those who are dying, those who are struggling to live with illness, those who have mental illness, those who are dealing with the illness that is violence in our world, domestic violence and domestic abuse, violence in our communities, gun violence. And we lift them all up to you, and we entrust them to your arms, and we ask that you shelter them, that you protect them. We remember that you are our rock and our refuge, our present help in times of need. And so we lift up these needs for your help. Bring peace to this world. Bring healing to our communities, to our friends, to those whom we care for. Montana Lovelace, LaPierre, all of these whom we care about, whom we know, and whom we love, we ask for your blessing. We ask for your healing, and we ask for your peace. We ask as well for all those who have died, and we give thanks that they have a place with you. Help us to remember that we too have a place with you, and that soon we will be surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses who forever proclaims the glory of your name. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took a cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant shed in my blood. Drink, all of you. And whenever you do this in remembrance of me. For whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim Christ crucified, his dying and his rising, until he comes again. We're about to begin our communion ritual. I want to tell you a little bit about how we do that. We do it by intention. So you're invited to come forward as the ushers guide you and take a piece of bread. Our bread is gluten-free to make sure that everybody has a chance to participate in Christ's body. And then dip it into the cup that is next to it. If you are unable to get up or if it is difficult to you, I will come around and I will bring communion so that everybody has a chance to be a part of this incredible feast. Brothers and sisters and friends, these are the gifts of God for the people. Will the ushers please come?
Thank you.
join our voices in the prayer of the community.